I'm Martin Van Zyl from the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, here for the FITsontheGo blog. And I'm here with Dr. Gregory Schwartz from the University of Colorado, also the co-chair on the steering committee for the what's now being considered a landmark trial, the ODYSSEY trial. And thank you so much for being here with us.
My pleasure.
So first question I had for you, for those of us that haven't been able to attend the presentations here at ACC 2018, could you give us a brief summary of the ODYSSEY trial?
Sure, I'd be happy to. First, I'll say that I think the attribution of landmark requires a little bit of a passage of time. Yeah. So I'm delighted that it would even be considered as such, but we'll see. Time will tell how it sorts out. So the ODYSSEY trial tested the hypothesis that adding a PCSK9 antibody, in this case alirocumab, to very best statin therapy in patients with less than or undesirably high levels of LDL cholesterol could further reduce the risk of recurrent ischemic events after acute coronary syndrome. And it really does represent a stage on a long odyssey of attempts to reduce risk after acute coronary syndrome that's gone on over several decades and has included evolution of antiplatelet therapy, the use of intensive statins after acute coronary syndrome. But even with all those evidence-based approaches, revascularization strategies, the risk is very high. And this is an attempt to further reduce it for our highest risk patients with coronary heart disease.
Excellent. And it's been very interesting hearing the new developments from this trial. And some of the critics have been saying with the CANTOS trial, anti-inflammatories are now showing benefit for recurrence of MI prevention. Mm-hmm. What do you have to say for those people that are now saying that we're entering a post-cholesterol era?
Well, I think it's been established by many decades of both observational and interventional research that atherogenic lipoproteins are responsible in large part for the initiation and the progression of atherosclerosis, and conversely that reducing the levels of atherogenic lipoproteins, particularly with statins, can reduce that risk. And then we saw with the Improve It trial a few years ago that a non-statin intervention added on to statins could reduce the risk after acute coronary syndrome. And so we tried to leverage that proof of concept with a much more potent LDL cholesterol lowering intervention, which is the PCSK9 inhibitor in the form of a monoclonal antibody. And so we enrolled patients, almost 19,000 of them from around the globe, who had a recent acute coronary syndrome, were on top doses of Atorva or rosuvastatin or the maximum doses they could tolerate, and despite those therapies had LDL cholesterol levels of at least 70 or non-HDL cholesterol levels of at least 100 milligrams per deciliter. And alirocumab compared with placebo in those patients reduced a composite MACE primary outcome, which was coronary heart disease death, MI, stroke, and unstable angina. And moreover, we found a reduction in all-cause mortality with alirocumab compared with placebo. And there are some statistical caveats that are attached to that observation, because when you're analyzing a number of secondary outcomes, you have to control the type 1 error in some way. And the way we did that was a hierarchical analysis where you proceed to the next assessment only if the previous ones have all been significant. So all-cause mortality was actually number 7 on a list of 7 hierarchical assessments, and 4 out of the 6 preceding endpoints were statistically significant, but immediately before all-cause mortality was coronary heart disease death and cardiovascular death. They were favorably influenced, but not significantly so. And therefore, the significant reduction in all-cause mortality that we observed, probably because there were just greater number of those events, even though the p-value associated with that was 0.026, we have to call that nominally significant because of the way we defined the analysis ahead of time. But all-cause mortality, obviously, is the ultimate outcome. And if we have something that actually saves lives, then I think we've made a contribution to patient care, which is what this business is all about.
Absolutely. That's very important. And how do you anticipate this impacting real-world patient care in the coming years?
It's a good question. You know, the trial had fairly broad inclusion criteria based on the lipid levels that I described. And one way of interpreting the trial is that, you know, we drew a big circle around patients who qualified for this trial. And if you had a patient that would fit inside that big circle, well, then the benefit should apply. And I think if this were a drug like aspirin or beta blockers, very inexpensive, we would say anybody who could have been in the trial as a patient, you should treat with this intervention. That's a difficult tack to take with a very expensive biologic therapy. So we looked at subgroups to see which subcategories of patients might derive the most benefit. And it does look like patients who have an LDL cholesterol level of at least 100, again, with best shot on goal with statins and other therapies, if they remain at 100 or above, those seem to be the patients who get the most benefit, both in terms of MACE and mortality with this approach. And they may be the ones who are should be treated first, let's put it that way.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much for being here, Dr. Schwartz. We really appreciate it. And for more videos like this, go to youtube.com/FitsOnTheGo.